Welcome back to another episode of It's What He Would Have Wanted. The he today is Verdi and the opera is Otello. Now, unlike our video on Massenet and Calvé, this wasn't written with a specific voice or performer in mind, but it might have been adapted for one. And Francesco Tamagno became so associated with this role that he might be one of the most famous originators in the history of opera. And he's really set the standard for all the Otellos to come after. Tamagno was the star tenor of the moment. So when it was discovered that Verdi was writing a new opera, many people assumed that the part would go to Tamagno. So Tamagno wrote a hopeful letter to Verdi and received a reply which said neither yes nor no. Verdi had very firm thoughts about how his music should be sung and what kind of voices were suited to each role. For example, he wasn't thrilled about the idea of Melba playing Desdemona, although he admired her very much. He wasn't at all sure that this role was going to suit her. And he said as much tactfully to Tamagno, "You know better than I do that, however fine an artist may be, he is not suited to every role, and I don't want to sacrifice anyone, least of all you." But he suggested that they meet up and have a chat about it. Verdi was concerned about Tamagno's suitability for Otello because Tamagno was not known for being a subtle singer. His appeal was that he had a very big voice. A very big voice. And where other tenors struggle with high Bs and Cs and C-sharps, Tamagno was right at home there. The sheer force of his voice was so thrilling that that's really what his fame was built on. Now, this would be fine for a warrior like Otello who needs to impress you with the power of his singing and his presence on stage, but Verdi was concerned because the character is more complex than that, and he wasn't sure that Tamagno was going to be up to the task. But Verdi had a solution. As the critic Henry Pleasant put it, here the subtlety has been written into the music by the composer. So although Tamagno might not have been entirely convincing in the love duet with Desdemona, the rest of the role suited him to a T. No one knew better than Tamagno himself that he was at his best in scenes of elemental intensity, in passionate situations where he could call upon his immense resources of voice and temperament for the expression of exultation, outrage, fury, resolve, or despair. The success of the opera was not just down to the famous composer's wonderful music or the experienced librettist's excellent adaptation of the play, but also largely thanks to the performances of its stars, Tamagno as Otello and Victor Morel as Iago, to the point that when it had a successful run elsewhere with different singers, Verdi joked, "I'd got so used to hearing people proclaim the glories of those two that I was almost persuaded they had written this Otello." Tamagno had a short career because it was discovered that he had a heart condition and he had to retire from the stage. But he continued to sing, and he made some of the earliest recordings, including some extracts from Otello, which we're now going to listen to. And although he was ill when he made these recordings and died not long after, how lucky we are that we can still get some impression of what made that performance legendary in its time. But first, let's listen to a modern acclaimed tenor singing the infamous entrance of Otello. It's only a short piece, but it should make a big impact. Hey, gloria! Oh. First of all, we can hear the current fashion for darkening the tone, and with that yawning, hollow quality, and the wide vibrato to which we become so accustomed, which makes it difficult to tell where the centre of the note is. But what specifically we can hear in this clip is that he doesn't sound very comfortable at either end of his range. So the lowest note in this is a G, and he sounds a bit like he's reaching down to it. He loses some of the power and some of the volume in his voice when he gets there. But you can hear it, it is a clear sound. However, at the other end, an octave above that, and an octave and a bit anyway, because it's a B, this little grace note, as it's written in the score, he has to force that note to the point that he's actually just shouting it, which is, as well as being harmful to the voice, a risky thing to do because he nearly cracks, like the tenor in the clip that you heard at the beginning of this video. Now, you might argue that this is getting too technical and really I should be talking about the style and interpretation of this piece of music. But technique has a big impact on style, because if you don't have the freedom of technique that allows you to do whatever you like stylistically, then you're going to be limited in your interpretation. Now let's hear how Tamagno tackles it. There can be no better example of freedom in technique. His tone is much brighter than the modern tenors. He has ease throughout his range, and his consonants are so free. There's no tension around them at all, even in the high notes. So every word is crystal clear. And as well as freedom in the voice, there's freedom in the time as well. The accompaniment here is as sparse, there's a lot of space for him to pull around the time as much as he wants. So he actually treats this more like recitative, and that gives it a declamatory style. And then, of course, there's that incredible trumpet-like attack, the way that he fearlessly hits those notes head on. There's no impression of scooping to the notes or sliding around at all. They have this great punch attack at the beginning of every note, so you really get a sense of the power of this voice. And finally, that high B, he treats it as a grace note. It sounds much more like a little flourish than a shouting match. After the first performance of Otello, a crowd gathered outside Verdi's hotel, and then on a balcony above their heads, Tamagno appeared and he sang the esultate for them. What a moment that must have been. Let's hear another extract from the opera with another modern tenor.
Ora e per sempre, addio, sante memorie, addio. Addio,
This time we can hear an inverted vibrato, which sounds sharp above the note. And it seems to me that this is caused by pushing the voice too hard, trying to force too much air through the throat. We don't get the trumpet-like attack, which would be so appropriate in a piece of this vigour. Instead, he's scooping up to almost every note. And again, he's shouting the high notes, the high A flat and B flat. I can't say that to me they sound like they're beautifully sung. What he does have in his favour is that, apart from dragging a little, he is singing it at the tempo that Verdi prescribed, which is more than you can say for Tamagno. Tamagno sings this much slower than is suggested in the score. As one analysis observes, various writers have assumed that Tamagno's treatment must have had Verdi's blessing, and that in the records we have a vital historical document concerning the authentic performance of this music. But Verdi was not at the recording session. Tamagno could have it all his own way, and he had a liking for slow speeds. However, his use of rubato, the way that he pulls around the time, is appropriate to the performance practices of the era, so that Verdi might not have had so much of a problem with, if he was unhappy with the slow and stately tempo that Tamagno picked. Despite his pulling around the time, the energy with which he sings this piece gives it a martial feel, which is helped along by the rapid and vigorous grace notes that he inserts. And his high notes really are beautifully sung. The B flat might be slightly flat, but it's such a ringing, bright, open sound. And then when he comes down into the lower notes, he covers them, he darkens them, which gives this sombre feel to the end of the piece. Now let's hear the end of the opera. Spoiler alert, if you didn't know already, Otello dies.
Thank you.
We have another type of vibrato done wrong. This would be described as a wobble because it's very wide and slow and out of control. As for the tone, it's squeezed and throaty, which means that he doesn't have the freedom for the variety of tone that this passage needs. It all comes across as quite flat. And then at the end of this little passage, he brings out the dramatics. We have sobbing and we have this rasping sound that he uses on Desdemona, which is his interpretation of grief. But, well, we know that Verdi hated that. He thought it was all very well in the theatre, which is a much more realistic medium, but that in opera, singers shouldn't make unmusical sounds, to the point that he's believed that Violetta should not cough in La Traviata. And he wrote into Lady Macbeth's music, he wrote the death rattle in the orchestra so that she would just have to sing it and not try to bring in any of these dramatic effects that some singers like to use. There was a tradition of using sobbing and gasping in a musical way, and we will definitely cover those techniques in a future video. That's how to introduce sobbing and sighing in a musical way. And anyone who ever doubted Tamagno's subtlety in singing, I think that that would definitely put their fears to rest. That high G sharp really sounds like a cry of pain, and yet still it's a beautiful note. Now that the score calls for some non-singing sounds, he doesn't deliver them. Here Verdi has written this cry, just the word ah, as the orchestra swells to a high C sharp, and I would think instinctively that you would want that cry to follow the shape of the phrase that the orchestra are playing, but here we've just been given a short ah. And then at the end, the final word, bacio, Verdi hasn't written a note for the last syllable. He means the voice to die away, but not to the point that it's inaudible. I think just so that it should be spoken rather than sung. Let's hear how Tamagno does that. I love the tender and romantic tone that he's brought into his voice for his last words to Desdemona. And as the morendo indicates, he's dying away at the end, getting softer, and lets his voice tremble. He has a present vibrato all the way through. It's a small, subtler vibrato than the modern tenors, more of a shimmer in the voice. But at the end here, he gives the feeling that his voice is trembling with emotion. And then, of course, that final death gasp, which is the only unmusical sound that he makes, it really gets me. I think it sounds so real, it sounds so painful and poignant.
This was probably not the darkest voice we have ever heard in this role. But his ringing sound was superb, and I'm sure that's what made this voice so loud, so present.
It's interesting to think that Tamagno would probably not be considered for this role today, because his voice isn't dark enough by modern standards. He'd have to artificially darken it to make the sound that we now expect from a dramatic tenor. But that's not what Verdi wanted. And we have a good idea of what Verdi wanted because he was so vocal about it. He had opinions on the staging, the acting, the singing, and the choice of performers. He chose Tamagno because he had the right kind of voice. And what we know of Tamagno's voice from listening to these records is that he had a bright sound, an open, ringing tone. And it was a strong voice, very powerful and loud, but it was also agile, with that effortlessness that Verdi loved. But he lacked the dramatic technique, he wasn't a natural actor. So Verdi coached him extensively in this part, not just in the physicality of it, but also in all those wonderful vocal effects that we've heard. The variation of tone that he uses, the covered sounds, the shaking of the voice, The use of rubato, pulling around the time, those sobs and sighs that he uses sparingly but in just the right places, these effects which had been common in an earlier era, previous generation which Verdi remembered and Tamagno probably didn't have much experience of. Verdi was a composer who knew singing very well, which is why he's one of the greatest opera composers to have ever lived. But he's dead now, and he can't complain anymore if people don't want to sing his music the way he wanted it to be sung. So should it matter? Should we not say that tenors should be allowed to put their own interpretation on the role? Well, of course they can, as long as they can convince us that it comes from freedom of technique, and not that they're being hindered by trying to artificially darken their high notes or force the voice to get a falsely powerful sound. And maybe it doesn't matter if that's not what he would have wanted. Well, in our next video, we might do something a little different rather than continuing this series. I've had some questions about legato, so I might go into more depth and detail about that. If you think you would be interested in hearing about legato, and then don't forget to subscribe and tap the notifications button so that you'll know as soon as that is uploaded. And stay tuned for the next seance with the Phantoms of the Opera.